And here we are. It is, strangely enough, it is Thursday. It is the 10th of March. And we have a very, 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 very special guest in the studio. Say hello to Dr. Associate Professor Dr. Marewa Glover, who's come all the way from Kiwi Land, from New Zealand, to be with us tonight. And another special guest, Keith. And he's brought two top potters tonight.
Hadn't realised that.
Yeah.
Yes,
so hello, good evening and welcome.
Kia ora.
And it's lovely to have you with us. We've played the title, so we've got nothing of that to go on. Mm. Welcome to England, and I'm sorry about the weather.
It was weird snow.
Where?
In your backyard.
That's very true. We did have snow.
Just
in the
a little bit.
I'm not going to tell everybody that you went out and danced in it.
Well, yeah. Tried to catch some.
When did we have snow? Did we?
Yes. We had snow the other day.
You must have been in bed.
It was a great thrill.
Do you not get snow in Auckland?
Not in Auckland, no.
No. So tonight I want to talk about e-cigs.
Really?
Did you not know? I should point out for everybody that's watching that Marewa has been at the University of Durham for 2 days this week. It was Tuesday and Wednesday, wasn't it?
Yes.
Monday night, Tuesday and Wednesday, speaking at the Breathe Symposium, is that?
Yes, Breathing in Context.
Yes, and we've had some lovely conversations about it. I think we might be touching on some of that during the course of the next hour and a half. And also, she delivered a keynote piece on Wednesday night, which we'll also have a little bit of a look at. So it's all going to be good.
But for no smoking day.
Yes.
Yep.
That's the last we're talking about smoking tonight, isn't it? We've had some good conversations, and I've been picking up some hints and tips, and this is going to tell us the way forward. It absolutely is. It's going to be grand. Right. So now let's look at New Zealand. We had a report from you and Rebecca a few weeks ago, and I want to talk about that a little bit later on. But what's the situation there? How is vaping there? What do you see the future for it? What do you want to see happen? This is the important stuff.
I think the really good developments are the vapors, online vapors groups, and they're starting to have vape meets. So we've had a series of those. You were there for the Auckland one.
It was fabulous.
I went down to the Wellington one. There's one in Tauranga coming up,
right.
And there's one in Christchurch. And I believe we might be getting a bricks and mortar store in Christchurch. And so the launch and vape meet will celebrate that.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a lot of celebration and just vapers getting together and enjoying themselves together, and you know, sharing vaping in a positive way.
Right.
That's really good. And also those groups are getting a little bit active. So it's really a really positive advancement to have vapers speaking out politically on the radio, writing to MPs, telling their stories. That's we really need vapers to tell their stories to members of parliament, the Ministry of Health, and just to talk to doctors, nurses,
okay.
And health workers.
Have you got a handle on how many vapers there are in New Zealand?
No, but we did a survey. Trish Fraser, Penny Truman and Murray Logeson and I have just finished an online survey of just New Zealand vapers. And we were only expecting 150, and we got about 300 people, or more than 300. So that was pretty good. Yeah, and we're looking forward to analysing that data.
Excellent. Sorry, I got slightly sidetracked there because chat is telling us that there's a slight echo on the mics. Now, let me just, it's not your fault. This is my fault. Let me explain to everybody what's happening. Under normal circumstances, we've got two mics running at any given time and they're balanced against each other and they're the same distance from each other's voices. Tonight, we've put a third in and it's picking everybody up. I'm hoping it's not too bad, but Matt's going to let me know now what it's like. Matt? Oh, he's still listening. He's having a listen. I think we're all right, though. As long as everybody can understand what's going on, that's fine. And I can see at the moment Matt's listening, and apparently the echo's gone, has it? It'll be interesting to see. Yeah, it sounds good now. Right. That's what chat's telling us. So I'm sorry about that, Mario.
No, that's all right.
So, right, you're looking at a fairly good number of vapers within New Zealand. They're starting now to speak out. We've got the thumbs up from that. That's great.
Yeah.
So they're starting to speak out. Are they organised yet? There's a
New Zealand Vaping Alliance group, which is for retailers, but also vapers can join that as well to support political action and advocacy work.
Uh-huh.
There's the Vapers NZ, NZ Vapers, Wellington Vapers, and they're all groups on Facebook. And they occasionally, you know, if called upon, they'll do something as well.
So do they kind of meet up outside of online media? Do they get together and have, you know,
vape meets and just sort of maybe not a vape meet as such, but just getting together. So picking a venue and saying, let's all meet there and coming together. So
it's more of an ad hoc thing rather than a fully organised.
Oh, no, they do organise it within the group, but it's not like a vape fest or a vape day, just vape meets.
So clubs?
Sort of, yeah.
Like a club, just a club like bikers getting together.
And new people can come along and learn from more experienced vapers, you know, about equipment and...
So you give the impression this is a fairly recent development. And I was just going to ask, why is that, do you think?
Well, it might be because I've been to one and been hooked in, so I'm on the Facebook groups and I'm learning a lot from them by being in there.
Right.
I think it's important for researchers to actually have contact with vapors.
Yeah, well, quite, yeah.
Talk with them.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'm totally taking a book.
And like... handle the e-cigarettes and find out how they work, you know.
I want you to be very careful here. I don't want to get you in any trouble on the show tonight. I mean, come on, holding an e-cig, you've been talking to vapors, you're a researcher, a doctor. Are you sure this is all okay?
Well, hopefully I'll have a job when I go back.
Let's hope so too. When we were over there, I couldn't help notice, and I said it when we got back and while we were periscoping, I didn't really see all that many vapors in the wild over there. Has that changed any?
I think it might be. I have been, I don't go out that much, but, you know, when I do go out, I have been seeing one or two.
Okay.
We went out to dinner and, there's some people vaping. I went to... a poetry slam event and there was somebody vaping, so
and we know there are vape friendly venues over there, pubs.
Yes,
So when we've been talking over the course of the last week or so, you've kind of expressed a view that is quite contrary to where we are in the UK, where we're going to have regulation thrust upon us whether we like it or not. But you don't really like the idea of regulation in New Zealand, do you?
No, I don't really see the need for it. I think that e-cigarettes can stay as a consumer product. The only problem we have is that the nicotine e-liquid is illegal to import and sell, so people can only buy it over the internet. And I think that would be good. I think that the ministry, you see, they've defined it as an oral tobacco product. And I think you could probably argue that the nicotine e-liquid is not oral. You're inhaling it.
Yes.
Whereas the oral phrase was designed to stop chewing tobacco and snus.
Right.
Yes.
And you're not putting the e-liquid in your mouth.
In your mouth.
Mm. No. So I think we could argue that is not oral. And therefore it is not covered by that phrase. But however, that's in terms of regulation, if we have to go down that track, then we're going to have a lot of very concerned people shoving as much as they can into that. So as soon as we start doing an amendment to the Smoke Free Environments Act, so we can get access to nicotine e-liquid or nicotine containing e-cigarettes, there's going to be a whole lot of other stuff shoved in there into the wording. Oh, let's push for this now, and let's get, you know, smoke-free streets and
debt-free streets.
All sorts will be shoved in there. A whole heap of time is going to go into it. It'll cost over $1 million, maybe two, to even go through that whole legislative consultative process. I think we have far more important issues to deal with, big health issues that we need to deal with. And for New Zealand's small health budget, it's just not a public health issue that should be up there.
It's quite a refreshing thing to say, isn't it, that e-cigs just aren't a public health issue.
No, they're not.
I'm just going to say Mark Drakeford and various other personalities within the UK, e-cigs are not a public health issue.
Oh, well, perhaps you've got more money to throw around on things that are not really an issue.
Well, it's only getting thrown in one direction, and it's not in the direction of vapors, I can tell you that.
Do you have obesity, alcohol abuse, road crashes?
Excuse me, what a question to ask when you say
so. Is there a high incidence of tobacco smoking in New Zealand? I'm just thinking of the situation here in the UK. How would you compare that in terms of the number of people who actually smoke tobacco?
Overall, it's down to 15% daily smokers.
Right.
So less than, I think you're sitting around 20-something?
The government has been very proud to announce that we got to 18.5.
Daily smokers?
Yes, 18.5%.
Okay.
Following massive uptake of e-cigarettes, apparently.
Oh, well, we see we haven't had that. So 15% without the massive uptake of e-cigarettes.
Right.
But huge disparities. So Māori smoking is at 38%. Pacific Island people in New Zealand, 25% of them smoke. And then if you started looking into people with, you know, mental illnesses,
yeah.
So there's huge disparities by ethnicity, gender, and, you know, comorbid conditions.
Yes.
So it's not equitable across the board, and that's what I'm really concerned about. 650 Māori a year keep dying from tobacco-related illnesses. So for Māori, tobacco smoking is still number one, and then we've got obesity to deal with. And then I think violence of all sorts, and, you know, then maybe alcohol abuse
further down the road.
But e-cigs, no, I'm sorry, there's no harm, there's no, you know, it's not a public health issue. For some people it's a nuisance problem, that's all.
Yes.
But of course, presumably you won't have in New Zealand the layers of bureaucracy that we have here in terms of, you know, our own government, our own parliament, and then of course the European question.
Yes. I'm pretty sure we have not enforced that cucumbers have to be straight.
Yes, quite.
I'm quite concerned for you over here.
They're by home to tell. Because while we were talking earlier on in the week, I told Mario that according to the European Union, cucumbers are supposed to be straight.
I'm still not sure whether I should believe you on this one.
It is straight. It's true. It's just idiocy. Yes, that's exactly the case. I'm just getting the message that DD still has a slight echo. It's as good as it's going to get. There's nothing much I can do to change it, I'm afraid. It's because the microphone is quite a way away from me. We'll try and have a look at it during a piece of video that's going to be coming up fairly shortly. No, trust me on this one. The European Union gets stuck into absolutely everything. And yes, bananas are supposed to be straight, other than for the curvy bit where they connect onto the stalk. Cucumbers are supposed to be straight. That's why you can't buy long ones anymore.
I think there's some people up in the bureaucracy somewhere having a lot of fun with you guys. And I'm a bit concerned about if your public is going to be that compliant, that idiotic things like that can come in and there's no objection, then sorry, e-cigs, you know.
are you suggesting we should be less compliant with the EU?
I'm a little bit worried.
Well, there is an argument, of course, that in typical British style, we follow everything they tell us to do, while of course some of our European partners don't. I'm right there, aren't I?
I think you're absolutely right, Keith, yes.
You know, we do as we're told, whilst other European countries somehow or other manage to circumvent that for years.
No, you've got to protest. Get out on the street with banners and don't stand for the straight cucumber business. This is ridiculous. What hope have you got to save nicotine, e-liquid and vaping and e-cigarettes? Only the fact that maybe so many of your population are using them already.
Mm.
So it's, as they'd say, the horse is bolted. Unfortunately, in New Zealand, I think people, the horse, they're trying to chase it down and wrangle it to the ground, put it to death.
Yes, well, Australia is...
poor Australia.
The West Island.
So sorry, you guys.
Yes.
Donna and Attila.
Yeah, we've just read up on the ACT stuff that's been going on, and that's absolutely shocking. Mm. But, of course, let's try and keep on to positive things if we can, and we'll cover the heavy politics.
Positive things, yeah.
Yeah, go on. Alcohol's way down the list. That's a gin. One of the things that you said when you were coming over was there were things you wanted to see, and Jill and I wondered what that might be. I'm getting thumbs up from Matt, so that's good. So we took Marewa out because she said she wanted to see some vape shops.
Oh, yes.
So we went we went down to the galleries, of all places.
Well, that's a good place to go to.
It's jam-packed with vape shops. And here's a little bit of video showing you it all happening.
Because it's illegal to sell the nicotine.
Yeah.
So I wanted to see, I wanted to see examples of your shops or kiosks. So they bought me to have a look. Yeah.
Right.
So your own range of e-cigarettes.
Yeah.
And juice.
It's our own made, yeah.
Do you want our leaflets?
Oh, yeah, okay. So is the concept of it looking like a cigarette packet, it's to help people with that transition?
I think it is. Important at the same time to drive the other.
So that was Marewa down in Washington Galleries looking at and we've only got video of two or three of the places that we went and looked. What did you make of it?
Well, what was really interesting was the different types of retail models. So you've got the kiosk, the very sort of upmarket VIP kiosk, and then we went down this other sort of market stall type thing where there were just sort of open stalls then you had two e-liquid stalls opposite each other. And the other thing was that both the people working in those vape themselves.
Yes.
So they were vaping. They clearly knew about the product and people were talking to them and asking questions, which is different from what we have at home. I think you visit a store
mm-hmm.
and And I've been in to have a look at those. They don't really talk to you about the product. You know, you don't feel like they are vapors. They don't, you know, they just have the product to sell. And the range that you have. And then there were another couple of stores that were not vape shops.
The head shops, yeah.
Sold other stuff.
Well, one was a head shop, so all of the paraphernalia for herbal substances, was there. The other one is a computer store that has a pretty good selection of stuff.
They had like iPad covers and phone covers, yes, and things, and then on the counter a stand with e-liquids. So there's sort of four different types. The other thing was that head shop, that, you know, they had something that looked like this, but it wasn't. So it was like a knockoff.
Yes.
It looked like a knockoff.
Yes.
And so that was interesting. And then you took me to a different shopping centre, more upmarket shopping centre, Metro. And there was a VIP shop, and it was really flash, you know, like a very high fashion shop.
Oh, I didn't know there was a VIP shop in the Metro.
And it had a couple of tables and chairs. And I asked the woman at the counter, what are the tables and chairs for? And because I thought, do they sit there and have like a session with people and work out, you know, what they want or would like? And she said, oh, that's just for vapors to come in and sit and have a vape, because they're not allowed to vape out in the mall.
Oh, is that the one that is in what used to be the Antique Village?
Yes.
Tables.
Yes.
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 Yeah. So that was a very nice, yes, a nice touch.
Yes, over by Costa.
Yes.
Yeah, quite, yes, flash. You can come, and she said, yeah, vapors just pop in, sit down, have a vape. They don't even necessarily buy anything. That was fine with them. And
yeah.
So that's another sort of, you know, quite nice model. Whereas we've only got a few shops, women that I know don't really like going into them, because, yeah, they sell other stuff and it's not that comfortable.
No.
No.
Yeah, I don't know how many people actually use the head shop one. And I've not seen people in there buying e-cigs, but I have seen them buying other stuff. But they sell jewellery, they sell all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
It used to be purely a head shop.
Mm.
Now you can get all kinds of.
I didn't know that place that sold phone and
the phone covers. Yeah.
Sold e-cigs. Mm. I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's the one by the exit.
You see, because the New Zealand market's so small, I think it would be very risky to set up a whole shop, a dedicated shop. So it's important to have sort of different models for retail.
The fallback.
Yeah, if the market just isn't there. Although the Hawke's Bay Vapor shop's doing quite well since the tax increase 1 January, and he's had to put on extra staff.
I was going to say, I'd heard he'd been taking extra stuff on.
So what about the supermarkets in New Zealand?
No, if they stock anything, it would be sort of old, first generation, hopeless, cellar-like things in a packet, one-off use. And yeah, I don't think we wouldn't want anyone really wasting their money on those.
Mm.
So it's quite a difference in the environment than in the UK versus New Zealand.
Yes, the other huge difference was the way everyone at the galleries, I was watching the passers-by, you know, there was just no reaction at all. They just walk on about their business. There was no reaction to the retailer or you vaping. It was like everyone knew what it was and they weren't interested, and people just came up and bought what they want and go, you know, there was like no...
Because that one in Sainsbury's has been there a long time. That's quite a long time.
Mm.
The chaos outside.
What's moved?
Yes, I noticed today.
Yeah, it's bigger and better. Moved across into the centre of it, so it's by the bigger entrance. But yeah, I mean, in the in-shops part, nobody bats an eyelid.
No.
There can be, you know,
there's no
cloud chasing.
Dirty looks.
No.
There's no, you know, waving. And even at the symposium that I was at, people just you know, just weren't that interested, really. It's like not an issue. And
well, you see, only a couple of weeks ago in the metro centre, I was stopped. I mean, I just pulled it out of my pocket and took a quick puff. And this guy came up to me, this security guard. You're not allowed to vape in here.
Mm. Can I just point out, because I was just watching the meters and what have you, when you were telling that tailor being caught for being naughty, you went all quiet and very conspiratorial about
yes,
it all.
Well, I was quite surprised at that in such a fairly open environment.
Mm.
And there's no notices.
No notices at all.
I mean, you know, if there's a notice up at the entrance to any given place that says, you may not vape, then that's not really an issue, is it? It's when there's no notice, you kind of well, it must be all right.
I mean, that's one of the largest shopping centres in Europe.
Mm.
I mean, I don't know how it compares with places like the Trafford Centre, whether you can vape in there or...
I think you saw someone vaping there the other day.
Yeah.
So, I know.
Well,
maybe it's just,
I was just bad
security,
luck. There was some guy coming past.
But the woman in the VIP store, she knew that people were not allowed to vape out there, so they'd provide a space.
Yes.
So next time you can go in there.
Quite, yes.
Yes.
And the other thing at the symposium I was at, I told people, and one woman said, I've never really seen one. And I said, here's one, you know, so I could show people.
Yes.
And she said, can I have a go? And they were really interested to, you know, to have a go. Most of them were anthropologists or, you know, she was an expert in sort of yogic breathing methods. They're just, you know, it's as if they just intuitively know that it's not harmful. And they don't, you know, they just want to learn about it. The openness, whereas in New Zealand it's like
the whole thing's much more low key. Yes.
Well, it's really skeptical, and you know, people are negative, and you know, instead of being open and like, I'd like to learn about this, you know. No, it's just be negative to start with, and
really.
So it's yeah, you've got it good in that sense.
It beggars belief, doesn't it? It absolutely beggars belief.
Mm.
Right, Matt was saying he's listening very carefully. Actually, I've lost the picture completely from the hangout. I need to repair that. So while I do that, did you know that Vape Jam is coming up? I think it's April Fool's Day and the 2 days thereafter. And apparently, VIP's going to be there. I know this because they've done an advert. And we're back. Sorry about that. I needed to fix it so I could see what was going on. So there you go. There is now a voice for vapers. VIP Vapers in Power is going to be at Vape Jam. So lie with the NNA, because we're sharing a stand with VIP. So that's all good. You know, you were talking... Well, no, I want to go somewhere else. I need to move that glass. Because when Mario arrived, I was brought a gift. And this is the gift
right,
I was brought.
Right,
now, I'm going to be really rude, Keith, and put this in front of your face, because I want people to have a look at it. And while I'm doing that, I want Mario to tell everybody what it is. So I go to Keith Cam, I reach in, and I do that. And will it help focus now, because it can see Keith? Damn, put my hands in front.
Well, do you want me to move temporarily?
No, it's all right. It's got the focus now. There you are. There's focus. So go on, Mario. Tell everybody about it.
Well, Phil in Wellington makes these. Phil the Vape Slinger. And they're a beautiful piece of work. And
it is.
So I just wanted to get you one as a gift. So I sort of suggested, I asked, oh, I've left it really late, but, you know, I should have thought about this earlier, and next minute he'd made it for you, with you in mind.
Yes, it has, and I wasn't able to get this on closer. I'll try again and see whether I can manage. If you can, I don't know whether you'll be able to see. There you go, at the base down here, you'll see a stylized cross. This is the cross that you would have seen had you gone to Durham and gone to the Prince Bishop's car park. It is St Cuthbert's cross, so it is specific to the northeast. That's a little bit...
That's where he's from.
I know.
Really?
Yes. I heard him speak the other day.
Right.
And to look at him, right, and I've got no pictures of him at all, unfortunately.
He's on Twitter.
He is on Twitter, yeah. But he's got this wonderful set of facial fur.
Right.
And it's not stuck on. This is the real I am.
And he's actually from the North.
Yes.
Well, he opened his mouth and it was like, all right, buddy, how are you doing in the North? Do you understand anything he says?
I don't need to. We tweet and Facebook.
So you do it all in textual... Yes. Yes.
Henley Solway on Twitter.
I mean, the fact that the St Cuthbert's cross is incorporated into the design.
It's a little bit nice. A little bit, what's the word? Bespoke. A little bit bespoke.
It's an artwork, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think it's really important in for this new culture of vaping to have artwork and art, you know, art, drama, you know, more poetry. There's someone that wants to do a dance with vaping incorporated into it.
In fact, it puts a whole new slant, doesn't it, on the design concept. I mean, what you're saying, you know, to illustrate various art forms.
Yeah.
Can I just have a look?
Every culture has art as a way of, you know, forming an identity and I think that this is
beautifully made.
You need more of this.
That's the work of an artisanal master.
Yes.
What I'll do next week, perhaps, or maybe the week after, I'll take a close look at it and kind of dissect it all down for you. Now, there are some lessons to learn from this. And I'll cover those in a couple of weeks' time. But Mario, you learned something from it as well.
Yes, because I had no idea what I was giving you.
Right.
It's a hybrid. And Mario and I spoke about this because there are issues with hybrids for brand new beginners. But if you know what you're doing, actually, this thing feels so bloody nice in the hand. But I'll go into it in great depth next week or the week after. I'll give you all the close-ups. You can have a look at the workmanship on it. And I mean, seriously, I wish I could do this. This has been so well thought out. It's really, really nice.
But I just bought you the casing, and
then you had
to build the rest of it. So there's a bit more involved.
I put a Vulcan on top because it was the one that was going to work with it. And like I say, a week or two's time, we'll have a really close look at it and I'll kind of go through and cover it all.
But in a sense, it introduces a completely new concept, doesn't it?
The concept of art.
Yes. Individuality.
One of the things we've been discussing, and I think it's safe to say, Mario, we have spoken at length. In fact, Mario tweeted the other day... that she'd beaten me. She actually got me to the point where I couldn't talk anymore.
I find that hard to believe.
It's perfectly true. I had to throw the towel in.
4:30 in the morning, he was like, I've got to go to bed.
Well, that must be a gift. That's it. You know, with David, it really must be.
It came as a surprise to me, I'm here to tell you. I've never been out-talked before.
Never out-talked that I know of. And I've known him 25 years.
It's the jet lag. It's all right. I'm awake when everyone's asleep.
You forget I watched you in Durham last night. The jet lag's got nothing to do with it. Talking about which, I want to play this in. This piece last night. I want to put this the right way. I think we are in the presence of greatness, Keith and I.
Oh.
Yes.
And I'm going to tell you for why. We've known each other since Warsaw, a little before on Twitter, but I don't count Twitter as like knowing somebody. But we met and we talked a lot in Warsaw. Obviously, when we came across to New Zealand, we've spoken a lot over there. And my God, have we ever talked on this visit. But there are very, very few people that I have met in this life that I can put my hand on my heart and say are 100% honest. 100%
Some people
honest.
Find that a bit of a problem.
I'm in the presence of two such people tonight here in the studio. And
Matt looks very worried.
You know, he's listening. Matt's concentrating. That's all it is he's doing. Look, I'll let the world see. He's just concentrating. That's all it is. So last night, I wasn't quite certain where everything was going to go. And what I heard was total honesty. And you'll see why I've said that when you watch this for the next 4 minutes or so.
The demonization of nicotine, we deliberately, in tobacco control globally, we deliberately demonize nicotine to scare people off smoking. It was one of our strategies. One of the unintended consequences of that, unfortunately, was it scared people off nicotine replacement products as well, and so we kind of had to back them, oh no, these are not as dangerous. But it also, it scares people off using the nicotine e-liquid anyway. So we do have people trying to quit with e-cigarettes and trying not to use the nicotine e-liquid as well. And I think you have a bit of a trend here. I think it's quite common that vapors think they need to get off the nicotine. And so people are sort of trying to wean themselves off it. Then there's unfounded claims that e-cigarettes are a gateway for youth. Youth are going to, they're going to try an electronic cigarette and then they're going to go to smoking. And there's no evidence globally so far that that is happening. If anything, it's a gateway. It's like they're coming up to smoking and they go, oh, I'll do that instead. It's healthier. And then there's unfounded fears that e-cigarettes will undermine smoke-free New Zealand. So we have the smoke-free New Zealand, and we're not going to get there if people start blowing white cloud everywhere. Māori women want to use e-cigarettes. And Māori, I think, again, it is Māori leading the lobbying and advocacy and openness towards e-cigarettes, because we are seeing... nothing else has worked, and that this might work. And then, you know, some of us, we've given electronic cigarettes to our family. Doctors with Māori members of their family are giving electronic cigarettes to their own family members. We're seeing people quitting. There's one woman who is not funded by government. She's now running Vape to Save groups. She came to Dave's seminar when he came to New Zealand, and I was very grateful that Dave and Jill came over to, we're trying to educate people, and now she runs Vape to Save groups, which are about financial literacy, but as part of that, the participants receive an electronic cigarette for free. She helps them learn how to order online their nicotine e-liquid. She can help them decide what strength. She's a long experience as a cessation worker. And they're saving up to $20 a day because vaping is so much cheaper. The other thing that's come out of her groups is that they don't feel driven to eat and thus gain weight. I haven't got the obesity figures here for you, but 60% of Māori are overweight or obese. So we have that's the next issue I need to get on to. It's like helping everyone stop smoking. You turn around and you go, what have you done? What are you doing? What? And now that we've got this other problem. And there are, you know, there is definitely some grounds for, you know, when people give up smoking, they can expect to put on 5 to 8 kilos and basically returning to the weight they would have been if they hadn't smoked. So there is something in it, but it doesn't account for the large weight gain across the population that we've seen. So there's real sort of, they feel some benefits, and then they're also getting health improvement.
And you catch us in mid
yes.
Yes. 5 to 8 kilograms.
Well, that's an average, so some people put on a lot more.
Well, all of those of you out there that haven't put anything on, I'm doing it for you. Yeah. I'm taking one for the team. As you do. Now, right. That was honest, wasn't it?
Yeah.
That was absolutely honest. Yeah. One, what's happening now isn't working. And
yeah.
Two, nicotine was demonised on purpose to put people off smoking, and it's kind of carried on.
Yeah. Oh, on purpose, another strategy that, you know, I really don't like is shaming people on purpose. So mass media campaigns that try and make smokers feel really, really ashamed, you know? Look at your children outside or inside while you're outside and they're lonely, and really victimizing and shaming people. And it's based on the belief that you need to create cognitive dissonance. So this is the behavioral change theory. We've got to help smokers. We've got to create this cognitive dissonance. If people feel cognitive dissonance, then they will do something to try and get rid of that, to try and return to, you know, feeling okay. So things you can do to create cognitive dissonance is sort of, well, you want to be healthy, don't you? Yes, you want to be healthy, don't you? Yeah. And then we say, well, you're not healthy, you know. So you've got to create this, you know, that what they want conflicts with what they're doing, and that creates cognitive dissonance. You want this for your children, but you're being a neglectful, horrible parent, you know. And that's what the mass media campaigns are trying to do, make you feel really, really bad, ashamed, embarrassed, plus, you know, incite hate towards smokers, so that other people in society will, like, look at you with dirty looks and, like, you know, look down on you. And, I mean, pregnant women in New Zealand, especially if they're Māori, they have people come up to them on the street and abuse them.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. Open abuse. It's just, and that has been, what do you call it, you know, when you incite hatred towards a group, that's what public health have been doing.
God.
And it's based on this theory of, you know, you need to create cognitive dissonance, and the researchers write it in their paper quite openly, you know, about creating cognitive dissonance. So it's got to make you feel bad, it's absolutely deliberate. And now, of course, as you know, they're just transferring that and doing that to people who vape.
Is there not evidence, and I'm basing this on personal experience, that members of the medical profession, when they're treating smokers, are not as critical as they used to be, say, going back 20 years.
Yeah. I think nurses have a lot of compassion. You know, doctors probably too, but I'm talking like health promotion and tobacco control academics.
Yes.
They don't work one-on-one with people. They're not at the hospital bed with people who are suffering. So, you know, I think there's a real lack of compassion. There's a real belief in this theory of how to change behavior. And, you know, if you've had a dog, you know it works. Get that choke. You know, punishment. I mean, you can try the...
But
biscuits,
you know, I was going to say, even with dogs, we've stopped the choke chain thing.
Oh, have you? Oh.
Yeah, I mean...
I'm... Oh, well, we're still doing it to people, especially vapors and smokers, yeah.
Really? Choke chain, not the little treats.
Yeah, no, not the little treats.
I remember 30 years ago, going to a doctor because I had a cold and a cough, and he asked the question, do you smoke? I said, yes, I do. he said, well, if you had a cut on your arm, you wouldn't rub acid into it, would you? And I was just dismissed.
In other words, you idiot.
Yes, and then I passed the surgery the next day and the same guy is coming out with a bloody cigar in his mouth.
Oh.
So, you know, well,
yeah.
And I think doctors now, and well, I don't think they're as critical if you go and see your GP as they were years ago.
Well, they've been told not to be.
Well, I'm sure they have, sort of much more customer friendly and in a sense supportive in, you know, the problem.
Uplifting. Yeah. And yeah. You feel like you can actually change your behaviour. Look, the fact is some people respond to a whipping.
Yes.
And others just feel really bad and go and have a smoke. You know, they're like, others are not going to feel good. That is going to make them feel more stressful. But I would say on the whole, some of our tobacco control experts, people you really, really love.
I beg your pardon?
They prefer the whipping method, you know, just whip them. Make them feel bad. Look, heaps of them don't like that and they will change. And that's what's happening. So I think, you know, we need people who smoke and people who vape to start complaining. If you have a health and disability commissioner like we do at home, make a complaint. If you get treated badly, if you go in and you get a whipping, complain.
Well, I've got to be honest, I've tried that. going back a couple of years, we had a guy caught. Well, it's not a couple of years, it's about a year. There was a fairly highfalutin doctor by the name of George Ray, was on a local radio show up here, and he spouted a whole load of lies, the same way as Drakeford's been spouting lies, and apparently another doctor called Burns, who was at a meeting with Louisa Ross, you know Louise, and again, just spouting lies left, right and centre, and both Clive Bates and myself wrote together to the General Medical Council to get them to get this guy Ray to wind his neck in, and they came back and said, no, it has nothing to do with us. Actually, what they meant was, no, he's one of the boys and he's doing what we've told him, what he's being told to do, so we're not going to touch him.
But when you go as a client to a doctor or to a healthcare service, you have rights, and if they mistreat you, if they make you feel bad, make a complaint. Don't, you know.
You see, I suppose in a way you can draw a comparison with, to some extent, with the way lepers used to be treated years ago.
That's right.
I've got to be honest, I'm surprised we're not walking around with little bells or
quite
little yellow crosses on our arms or something.
Oh, didn't one of the tobacco control academics actually suggest that at some point? Or you don't know that one?
Really?
I won't feed you anymore. You've got enough to do.
I actually am aware of that one, yes.
Oh, have a licence. You should carry a licence.
Licence. Yes. And which tobacco control academic would it be that came up with the idea
Let's
that
move
you should
on,
carry
shall
a
we?
Licence?
Yeah. Are we on a theme of lies and you're going to...
Well,
people lying.
What I wanted to get to was the fact that just from that last piece of video that we showed, you're honest, you're telling the truth. And one of the things that I wanted people to know was that last night there was some fairly, I'm going to call them highfalutin. If you were to look at their CVs of the papers they've published and the books that they've written and books that they've written in and the depth of research that they've done and the number of pieces of research that they've done, these CVs were massive. They were as long as your arm. These are folks that have been around an awful long time. And yet, as I was sitting watching their faces, I could see that they were taking in what you said. And, you'd see this when you mentioned the demonisation of nicotine. I specifically turned round to have a look at, I'm not going to name her because it would embarrass her. But she is a young lady that's very active in our own area. She's got a lovely fresh complexion. And she was nodding. In agreement. She was, yes, we've done that. And I could see the faces of the people in the audience going, she's right, we did, we have, and she's right, it doesn't work, and it's wrong, and we shouldn't do it. And I just got the feeling when we were doing the nibblies and drinkies thing afterwards, and talking to people there, there wasn't any negative comment about what had gone before. What I got was, and this was just me, and I want to ask you what your experience was then. I got one academic with a CV as long as your arm, as long as your leg, and as long as a giraffe's neck, all put together, saying his sister needs an e-cig. She tried a cigarette, couldn't get away with it. Was there any chance? And I said, yeah, it's not a problem. I've got some new stuff coming through that I need to try out with a complete beginner. So I'm sorry, the top pocket's going to be reffed on this one. So when that comes through, we're going to get together. I'm going to go through, we'll meet up, and this complete beginner is going to try what is a piece of kit that's intended for a complete beginner, but which appears to be...
Without a rubber band.
Sorry, no rubber bands, no.
Good.
This appears on the face of it to be TPD compliant. This could be what we're going to have come May of next year, not this year. Right. So that was the first thing. And then another young lady... extremely well qualified again, asking me all kinds of technical stuff about e-cigs to find out, you know, what is it that makes them tick? And she's kind of...
Yeah, they were like coming and saying, almost like asking you to blow a cloud so they could see what it was like. And
really?
They were very interested.
What did he smell of? Well, the kind of, this one smells of probably vanilla, well, vanilla, apple, a little bit of... Could I, fine.
And then they're going and they're putting their hands
wafting it across and having a feel of it and pulling it towards the nose.
Yeah, they were really, highly intelligent academics that work in sort of different fields, but, very interested to learn about it. And
The amount of... I've got... There's vanilla. There's some fruit.
Yeah, as I said, I had a couple want to try it. One was an Indian medical doctor, yes. A GP.
Yes.
And he was like, oh, yes, I want to have a go. And, they're open. That's the main thing we need, is for people to learn and not just act out of ignorance.
Yes.
And just from what they're hearing in the media or what they hear MPs say.
It was, I think there is a marked difference between the academics and the activist campaigners. But what
some academics, some.
Well, some are, yeah. Mm. Let's not name any names. We'll not mention Chapman. And just go from, no. But who?
He's in Australia.
Australia?
Yeah.
Oh,
no.
What?
Oh, I've been listening to this all week.
No, it's only once or twice. But Australian.
You see, it brings you back to this point of prejudice and tolerance,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, that's right.
I mean, right, you were almost, David, of the generation where smoking was the accepted thing. Mm. You know, you only need to look at a 1950s movie, don't you?
Mm.
You went to the cinema and you could hardly see the screen, for the smoke from people's cigarettes.
Well, I could never see the screen anyway. I was always in the back row with the
girlfriend. Yes. But you know where I'm coming from.
Trying to keep it clean tonight.
What?
Very difficult. Very difficult.
Did you
know where I'm coming from.
I resemble that remark. No, I know. I know exactly where you're coming from.
We
were talking about this before, and I was suggesting that, I mean, some of the people who are anti e-cigarettes, they fear that it's going to get to that again. They're afraid that it's going to go back to that, but this time it will be people blowing cloud. And so you've got to go to the cinema and they won't be able to see it because of the vapor. Yeah. It's they remember what it was like when everybody smoked everywhere and they're afraid that it's going to go back to that.
Yes.
Mm.
But I'm not even remotely sure that that's going to happen. I think vapors...
It's a fear.
Well, let's face it, the bulk of us currently, and this is, I'm leading into something, the bulk of us currently were smokers.
Yes.
So we remember, certainly the older ones amongst us, we remember what it was like. We remember that it wasn't easy to be kind of, as time went on, we knew we were getting vilified, we knew we were getting called out on various things that we didn't want to be called out on, possibly we didn't know any better, I don't know. But of course, as time goes on, there is the very strong likelihood that people, and you said this in there, that younger people are going to go, ooh, I'm toying with the idea of trying cigarettes, and then, to quote you, it's, oh, that exists, being e-cigs, and so they're going to go for that. So there will be, in the future, folks who have never smoked, never wanted to smoke, or might have thought something about it, but they are diverted by e-cigs and may stay on them for the rest of their lives. And when we were having a conversation the other day, if I've got it right, and I'd like you to confirm or deny, you said, but that doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't matter. It's recreational. Well, let's see, even if they use nicotine. I mean, in New Zealand, which I haven't looked at our data, so I'm not talking about our data from our survey, but I've been to vape meets. We have some people who are never smokers. Well, I met one. I've met one woman. She never smoked. And you've met her.
Uh-huh.
And she's a coil master. And she's a cloud chaser. And she doesn't use nicotine. What's wrong with what she's doing? Absolutely nothing. My nephew, I have a nephew who is a never smoker. And he has a vaporizer. I said to my cousin, but why? And she's like, well, because all his mates at work smoke, and they go out to smoke, and now, you know, he can go out with them. So he's using an electronic cigarette without nicotine to, you know, to help him.
Yeah.
So he's not pressured into smoking.
I think another thing is you could never regard smoking as a hobby, could you?
The pipes were...
Well, no, I'm really talking about cigarette smoking. Never, you could never regard it as a hobby. But, I mean...
Cigars and pipes, probably.
Vaping has become, with many
people... Some
people,
not, but not... You've got to have all sorts
of
vapors.
Well, of course you have.
You know.
So, I mean, I think there's another distinction without looking at the health issues that...
We have to be careful not to generalise and say that every vapor is an ex-smoker. Some will be never smokers. You young people who have diverted to that rather than starting to smoke. Some people who, like my nephew, work in a situation where all the other guys are smoking. He does not want to smoke. So he's clearly felt some of that peer pressure.
Yeah.
And instead he's going to vape. Good on him.
And he might end up converting some of his friends.
Well, he might. Yeah. He might. I don't think he bothers to try.
Yeah. Yes.
I don't think he's trying to do that.
In your experience or from what you've heard talking to folks in NZ, do smokers who see vapers together end up doing the kind of four-question thing that we were talking about at that seminar that we did down there?
Definitely, you know, definitely the vapors on the Facebook groups meet smokers, and they're absolutely open about, you know, they let people try their electronic cigarettes. Yeah. I mean, I was at an event recently for Spider Riders. Just to make you feel envious.
No, I'm not envious. I'm getting one.
and a great, we've got a great guy, Speedy, who he had throat cancer, and he had, you know, fairly seriously, he needed to stop smoking. He had a surgery and he relapsed to smoking. So he hunted out electronic cigarette, had to get it from the States. I think he went over there for a trip and he got an electronic cigarette while he was there. So he got himself onto electronic cigarettes, and he's just sort of on his own, you know, a solo. He's been vaping for quite a long time, many years. But yay, because he, you know, he had throat cancer. And he's a couple of the other guys that ride Spiders who were smokers are now vaping or... you know, at least transitioning. So we were at this event, and one of the guys that was also vaping was Speedy now. His wife was sitting over there smoking, and I thought, oh. And it occurred to me that maybe she's never seen women vaping, and she just thinks it's for men, so, you know.
Yeah.
I got mine, and I went and had a, no nicotine, I went and had a vape with Speedy and the woman's husband. just to sort of show, you know, women can vape as well.
Yeah. I'm going to interrupt at this point, and I'm trying not to talk too much because I'm aware of echo issues. But we need to confirm for everybody out there that you are not a vapor.
Oh, that's right. Yes, you've been calling me a vapor. No, I'm quite happy, you know, like with Speedy, go and have a Solidarity vape with them. The vapors in New Zealand are getting a pretty hard time. They get a lot of dirty looks. And some people have relapsed because of that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I think good on them, and I can go and have a Solidarity vape with no nicotine.
Yet. But we've got to make the point that, like Clinton, you never inhaled. You're not a vapor.
I think, you know, to being a vapor, that's like an identity.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't just sort of pick one up and have a go, and that makes you part of the community. Being a vapor is more than that. It's
So you were never a cigarette smoker.
Oh yes, I was. Why there's no way you're putting nicotine in that for me. I am an ex-smoker.
She's an ex-smoker, but she's not a vapor.
Right.
No.
And Jerry Stimson.
It's totally harmless. It's totally harmless. It doesn't. If I have a vape, so what? I'm not going to get hooked or anything. Nothing bad's going to happen to me.
Yeah.
You know.
Totally harmless.
Yeah, it is.
Totally harmless.
Well, for me it is.
For everybody. I mean, seriously, honestly, truthfully. We were talking again earlier on this week. Forgive me for saying that so much, everybody.
You have to make your own decision.
Well, yeah.
In this time when, you know, we have a lot of people sort of saying stuff that we don't actually know yet, it's up to everybody to make that decision for themselves. And I can read all the research. I try to keep up with most of it. And at the moment, as far as I'm concerned, that is not going to harm me at all.
Well, I would completely agree with you. I mean, everything I've looked at tells me that 95% figure that
at
has
least
been
95%, at least,
and the 5% is safer. There. It's there just to take account of anything that we haven't actually found out. But here's the thing: propylene glycol and glycerol in aerosol suspension has been in use for people to breathe in for over 40 years that I'm aware of, and it was probably in use before I was exposed to it. I used to be a sound engineer, and I would be sat, this would be my desk here, where all these bits and bobs with the slidey faders and knobs and all the rest. And right behind me, at the side of the stage, when I was monitoring engineer, would be a bank of six humongous great big haze machines and fog machines. And those things were pumping out 10 litres of this.
The same propylene glycol and vegetable glycerin has been used in medical devices as to deliver medicine.
Yes.
So, you know, we're dealing with something else. We are dealing with ideology and, you know, human behaviour.
Yes.
About in-groups, out-groups, discrimination, and we've been talking a lot because I was at the symposium on breath, and so I've been theorising about deep psychological reasons why people find the blowing of cloud, you know, challenging.
Shall we get into that?
Because, I don't know. I think it's a bit heavy.
Well, I know it's a little bit heavy, but I'd actually like to put it out there a little bit, not to preempt anything you're going to do academically. But it's kind of intuitive, actually, when we've spoken about it.
Do you want to ask your audience?
Yes, I do. Shall I explain it, or would you? Because you do it so much better than I do.
Okay, well, I think, you know, if you don't blow at me, but if you could blow one of your clouds...
I will blow a cloudlet.
This is what people have a problem with. So I'm sitting here, and if Dave happened to... Oh.
Is that enough?
Yes.
If Dave had happened to sort of blow in my direction. So So one thing, I have a psychology background. So one thing is that Dave's out-breath is made visible by the cloud. Usually we're breathing in and out, can't see your breath, you know, as long as it doesn't really smell. You know, we're not really offended by other people's breath. It's a normal thing we've all got used to, but we still have our personal space. You blow out this big cloud, perhaps you're sitting across the table and it comes towards me and I'm like, you know, if you're not my loved one, then, you know, hang on a minute, this is, your breath is coming at me and it's going to go into me. And that's kind of a little bit intimate and a little bit enforced intimacy. And I think it's probably triggering some deep stuff for people that they may not be aware of. Just this uncomfortable feeling of this enforced intimacy. I don't want your breath coming into me. Because that's something we reserve for our lovers our partners. Yeah. Are you getting a response? What do people think of that?
I think there's one there that starts probably picked up on, judging by the look on our face.
I've never really looked at it that way, but that's interesting. And you'd have to accept it's true.
Well, yes. there are.
You know, if you were blowing vapor or smoke or whatever into somebody's face, it is, in a sense, invading their personal space.
Well, there's another aspect, is that if you walk around the corner and you walk, someone just blew out a cloud and you walk into it, you're not going to sort of hold that against them. There was no intent in that. But what if somebody blew a cloud across the table, you're sitting there and, you know, and there was some intent in it. Is this person flirting with me?
Is this like the old blowing in the ear thing?
Yeah,
or is it an
aggressive thing? You know, are they trying to get at me? You know, it's, what do you think?
Well, I'm looking at Sav's face and I think, shut up. Just a second. I want Sav to bring in, because I know there's been comments in chat. Sav, what you got to say?
Well, the best comment so far from chat came from Lorian, who said you could have climbed on top of that cloud and had a little sleep.
people are saying that
they never thought about it in that way before.
No. I hadn't.
I've got a question, right? I've got a question for you. And actually, I've got two questions, and I kind of want to... Because this interests me, and it's not something I'd thought of. But, right, if somebody is close to you, this is no vapor at all, right? Just somebody, anybody, not a vapor, not a smoker, there are no preconditions to this. How far away is your personal space? Where does it start? Where do you get invaded? Where do you feel, is invaded the right word, or trespassed, or?
You know, if we're thinking about intimacy, you know, in an intimate act, like with the hongi, that can be very challenging for non-Māori people.
We need to explain to everybody what the hongi is.
The Māori greeting of pressing noses.
Would you care to demonstrate?
Oh, he just wants to do a hongi.
I've only ever hongied you once. Okay. The hongi.
Yeah.
Watch everybody.
The other way.
That way.
Yeah.
That way.
But you're a bit taller than me.
Okay. So that's the hongi. Right?
So that's a lot of people who are not used to Māori customs can find that very whoa.
So would that be a normal greeting, would it?
Not every day. It's a ceremonial, you know, for.
Let me put it like this. Māori was of the half, Steve. Fabulous, you'd love him. He's a brilliant bloke. And when...
He's like three quarters and I'm a quarter. He's kind of...
He's a big lad. He's a tall lad.
Right,
He and Mark and I could stand together and he's a slimmer, better looking version of both of us.
Right.
He's a tall, he's a big lad. But when we went to the household, to your place, I was welcomed into the household by Steve with the hongi. Now,
so the first time you're meeting somebody,
right?
And yeah, it's an act of respect.
But what I'm going to tell you is, as has just happened, there was a shiver went down my spine, because that, for me, was was intimate and it was saying to me, I accept you, you are who you are, and you've got that. For me, there was that immediate feeling of friendship.
And that is what the ceremony is about. We do it at the end of all of the speeches, and it is about now we are one. It's a sharing of breath, a sharing of souls, and you become one, you know, and then we can send them in to clean up the dishes, you see. But, no, it's for people who are not used to that, it can be very challenging. It's like, you know, ooh, this is a bit spooky, intimate, you know, I don't want to be sharing.
Particularly everything
an English thing.
Yes, yes.
Where the English, unlike even some of our continental cousins, and not like that, would step back from that.
Yeah. Well,
and in a sense, that's sad. That doesn't mean we are right by any means.
Mm.
Do you know where I'm coming from,
David?
Yeah,
and now...
Have you ever felt like you're losing control?
And sorry. Now, with your blowing cloud, I just think that for some people it's very challenging on a very similar level.
Well, this is we'll find out because our audience is composed, I would think, 99.9%
shopping trolleys.
No, neither do I. But well, let's face it, that's Lal. She's probably got one in the back of her shed. Sav, what have you made out of what Chat's had to say?
It's been quite interesting, not taking into account the different sexes that people were talking about, but we've had results from the closest is about 50 centimetres. The most common is arm's length, and the longest was 150 feet if possible.
I'm taking it that's somebody with intimacy issues. Just, I'm not even going to ask who it was, because I really don't want to know. Now, so here's the next question. Bearing in mind that the bulk of us are vapors, do you get offended by a cloud coming in your direction? Let's take the one that I blew out that Lorien could apparently sleep on, and I'm bearing that one in mind for the next time we're close to each other. Would you be offended by me blowing that in your presence? A simple yes or no, please, no more than that. Would you be offended by that cloud? It's going to help. Really, it is. Because this whole... I'm completely taken by this. And I couldn't... I hadn't ever thought about it before. But when you came out with it, when you mentioned it, I thought, actually, yes. Because I do know, as you know, Keith, a lot of people who, when you go to shake hands, it's at that distance.
Yes.
And I can't straighten my right arm. And they don't. Some people just don't like that. Their arms are poker straight when it comes out to shake.
Yes.
There's none of this bent arm. There's no getting it to kind of 18 inches. They want to be a good 4 feet away from you.
Yes.
And it, you're right. It is probably an English or a British thing. The stiff upper lip,
we've got people around the world who are having trouble with cloud, you know, with vaping.
Mm.
And I, you know, and they can say, oh, it's got some kind of, you know, as if they're transferring their fears of passive smoking. And this is some kind of passive vaping, and because I'm going to get it on me, you know, it's going to soak in or something. But we know that there is nothing, there's no grounds to that.
No.
So why are they still having such a problem? And... yeah, I just think it taps into sort of suppressed sexuality type stuff and sort of makes people feel uncomfortable. Well, you opened up the topic, and it's a bit heavy. Let's move on to something.
Well, right. just to cut that one off, because this is your field. If there's some work done into this further than what we've already seen at the symposium over the last couple of days...
Mm.
Do you think that could inform our way to educate those who might be offended by that, to kind of ameliorate their feelings?
I think we should explore it. I think we should explore, you know, because it really, I mean, a lot of us are going, what is their problem? You know, like, what's wrong? Like, don't they get it? And even though they might get it, they still got a problem. And they really hate the cloud. You know, in New Zealand, an official said, they don't have to blow cloud.
How would you react? I mean, in my case, right, I don't blow clouds.
You don't part with vapour at all.
But my wife's got a bronchial problem. And I would see her as being really discomforted for other reasons if someone was to blow vapour.
Jill said the other day, she doesn't like me blowing clouds when they roll over the table and fall on her arm because it's cold.
They're cold.
I've never noticed that.
No.
Roll your sleeve up. Either one, I'm not bothered.
Is your cloud cold? Do you know this?
Everybody.
Right.
This is
ready?
Something to try.
I've never noticed this. Right.
Grab a person near to you and...
No. You better lean back. You better lean back a bit. I don't want to discomfort you with my breath.
And that's what it is. It's discomforting people with your breath, you know. I can feel it's cold down on my knee. You're thick skinned, you can't
see. No, I must be thick.
It's an insensitive
I mean, very, very slightly, but I mean, if you hadn't told me, I wouldn't have.
Right. There's also that it's perfumed. You know,
yes.
We've had lots of discussions about perfume. You don't like, you know, if someone's heavily perfumed.
I've lost control again.
He likes to be in control, you know. Oh, yes.
No, usually I know where I'm going.
You're going to play a video?
No, I've run out of video to play. What I was going to say was, normally I know where I'm going, but I don't normally have...
I thought you were going to play that MP that was lying.
Oh, Drakeford.
Yeah.
I've decided to ignore the bastard.
Good.
Much the best
He's
thing.
He's listening to me.
Yes, I am.
Mm.
We're going to do that in the last 10 minutes.
More now. Ignoring of the negative, stressful, boring liars... And get on with celebrating vaping. You need to create culture, artwork, you know, songs, poetry. Do one of, you know, create a Georgie Ditty or whatever you call
Geordie.
It. Geordie. Oh, Geordie, sorry.
Yes.
Well, you know what I mean.
Only I'm a Macken. Anyway, there is a Geordie. There's a Geordie in the house. She keeps telling us this.
Yeah.
So, Sav, we asked two questions. There's been two questions asked.
She supports Newcastle, doesn't she?
Shush. We discovered this. There are three things you should never talk about in polite company. Politics, religion and football, so shush.
Right.
Sav.
Yes.
You magpie supporting...
Right.
With two questions asked. The first one was a yes or no answer. Was anybody upset?
It's my knee, it's not the chair.
There were it was called an obnoxious cloud by a few people, but mainly it was situational. If they were sitting in a restaurant, for example, a lot more people would find that offensive rather than if they were sitting in the front room.
Mm-hmm.
Yet some people ask their partners who don't vape or smoke, would you find that offensive? And again, we got a mixed result. Some were saying yes, others say no, not at all.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Nothing.
And the second point?
What was that?
I don't know, I've lost control.
I was hoping you'd know because I've lost it too.
Yes, this is what happens when I can't remember where I'm going.
Well, the other thing, it's not just... So one is that your breath is now visible. And as humans, depending on the different cultures, we have a lot of problems with breath. Especially if breath smells and body odors and things like that. So it means different things in different cultures. So bad breath in some cultures used to mean bad spirits.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so people were infected with bad spirits. And the other thing that I learned at the symposium was this concept of the skin being porous. And there used to be beliefs that we breathe through our skin.
Maybe that's where the cold feeling came from, because I've just remembered what the question was.
Okay.
Were people feeling cold, Sav?
Yes, I've just remembered as well. A lot of people said yes, that they noticed that their vapor was cold, and I think Ridian even said he can make his rain. But I think that's just Ridian.
I know this is
that's because he's Welsh. But I mean, you felt that on your knee, that it
yeah,
was...
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, someone thought I must be thick-skinned. This is not the chair. It moves my
you know, just sort of moving off at a tangent.
Yes.
That leads to the mystery of garlic. I went out for dinner the other night and there was garlic in the food.
Uh-huh.
And I came back and, of course, got into bed. And my wife sort of hit by this garlic. Yet if we'd both had garlic, you don't notice, do you?
Well, that's it entirely.
It's odd, that, isn't it, really?
So there's lots and lots of stuff about, you know, how people react to other people's breath, especially if it's not their partner or not an intimate partner. And if it's scented, so, you know, a lot of vapour, a lot of cloud is heavily scented.
Mine stinks of gin, whether I'm vaping or not.
Interesting. Yes.
Yeah, so, I mean, there are people like you who just sort of little, you know, you're most a stealth vapour there, you know, little.
He's never been any different. He parts with nothing. He's tight. He should have been the Yorkshireman.
People who put no flavour in, so there's not really much scent.
Right. Breath.
Breath.
Covered. I think it's very interesting.
Anyway, it's just a theory.
From an academic viewpoint, I can feel myself getting sucked into it, and I want to keep in touch on that, and we will anyway. Right, celebrating vaping.
Yeah.
Now, to put this into context, as I've said before, Marewa and I have had very long conversations, and trust me when I say you would have loved to have been part of it. It's been like this, but there have been times when we vehemently agreed, haven't we?
Disagreed.
No, and agreed.
Oh, agreed and disagreed.
We've both been saying the same thing, but from different angles.
We don't argue.
No, we discuss. There have been discussions and debates, and it's been fabulous. And I just wish that we'd been able to just set this all up and just do it.
You see, there's a unique gift there, I think, that you got.
Oh.
That you actually got him stuck for words. He dried up. Now, that's got to be a gift.
Well, sometimes
I've never known anybody.
You just listen and eventually people sort of run out of things to say.
Right.
He never does.
No, he never does.
I've lost control again. Right, now, look.
Ganging up on him, you see.
I know, I'm not used to this.
Weren't we going to talk about whales?
Whales?
Seals, whales.
No. Yes.
No. Oh, I thought you meant the country.
Australia.
Whales.
No, I wanted to talk about this celebrating.
Yes, okay. This is very, very important.
It is vital. Mm. We've had these conversations, as I say, and I wish you could have been part of them, and if it had been up to me, I'd have sorted it so you could, but seriously, at 4 o'clock in the morning, you'd have had to be in the antipodes, or the antipodes, or New Zealand, and the West Island of New Zealand. Australia! And Marewa came up with this, and I think she's right. One, e-cigs are bugger all to do with smoking. That's it, isn't it?
This is a new phenomenon.
It's a new phenomenon.
This is a new technology. This is a new phenomenon.
Yes.
And whilst it's starting, so I was actually telling Dave about after I'd been to GFN, and I went home and I had this dream. I dream in like Technicolor movies. And it was like a nightclub cafe, a late night bar cafe. It was a vaping cafe, and there was really great house music, and there were people in there vaping, and there was someone she was vaping pink cloud, and you said you can't vape colour, but you can vape in front of coloured lights, which would create it to make it look like it was pink. And I just sort of felt that I was seeing a future where vaping is just a subculture. It's just a subculture, and some people enjoy it. It's not a thing to worry about. And And at some point in the future, everyone would have stopped smoking. So the way it's going now, it's like all the smokers are going to eventually stop smoking, and if they use e-cigarettes and then they will stop smoking, there'll be no more smokers, and then there'll be no more vaping. I'm sorry, that's not what's going to happen.
No, it's not, is it?
And because new people will take this up, and there's a big, oh no, we can't have people take up vaping. But this technology will continue to evolve. It's a futuristic thing. It's something that's in the 21st century. It will develop. A subculture will develop around it. And that culture will have its own artwork, its own music, its own books. Steve Christie, author.
Yes, yes. Steve Christie, author, yes.
Writing it into books. It'll be in movies. We're already seeing a few people vaping in movies. It's just a subculture. Like getting tattoos is a subculture. You know, not everyone's going to go out and get a tattoo. And I don't really see a problem with it, you know. There's going to be lots of new things that humans do as we go into the future. This is one of them.
Yes. So on Vapor Trails TV on a Thursday, from here on forward, I pledge that we will celebrate vaping to its fullest. So here's a challenge for you. The poets amongst you.
Yeah.
Write me a poem. I will feature it, don't care how good or bad, because...
Some slam poetry, can perform, send you a little video clip.
Some what?
Yeah, slam poetry,
what's
performed
that?
Word poetry.
Right.
Yep, so they could send you maybe a video clip.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes.
Show some tricks, you know, maybe people could send you artwork they've done.
Yes.
It's about vaping.
Songs.
Yeah.
So, look.
Let you know about novels. Yes.
That feature vaping. That's artwork. That is artwork. That is artistic.
That's right.
So look, let's do this. Let's celebrate vaping. Let's ignore the Drakefords of this world. Let's ignore the naysayers of this world. And let us get out there and celebrate vaping publicly, loudly and proudly.
Yeah.
Without shame.
Yeah.
Without prevarication.
Have fun.
Without equivocation of any kind. Sorry. Let's do this. Let's celebrate what we know to be a good thing. And let us all together vape on, vape hard, and let's not let the bastards grind us down. Let us celebrate what we know to be good. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
Yes.
Then shall we all say it together, because we're just about the time. Sav, have we got anything to say before we go?
We have one comment that I want to say. And it's from one of our regular chat members, Gillis, and he said, I've absolutely loved just sitting listening to tonight's show. It's almost felt like I was sitting in the room during their interesting and informative chat. So many perspectives I had not thought about. Thank you.
Yes, that's true.
Kia ora.
Kia ora. Yes. Was that right, Kia ora?
Yes.
Right. So here's the thing. Let's change what I usually say.
Oh, right.
We're going to do vape on. We're going to do vape hard.
Yeah.
And let us all celebrate the vape.
Exactly.
Okay, so here we go. Is everybody ready? All do it together. Everybody. Matt, Sav, everybody. So, here we go. Vape on.
Vape on.
Vape hard. And let us celebrate the vape. Until we see you all next time from all of us here at VTTV Towers. Thank you so much for joining us. We thoroughly enjoyed, I think, spending the last hour and a half with you. And I look forward to seeing you again. From all of us here, for the time being.
Good night.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Bye.